You gotta keep your head up, oh, and you can let your head down, hey. You gotta keep your head up, oh, and you can let your head down, hey. I know it's hard, no, it's hard to remember sometimes, but you gotta keep your head up, oh, and you can let your head down,
hey. Hello, welcome to our program, Surviving Cancer and Transitioning to the New Normal. My name is Jaime Wolf, and this is my best friend, Kimberley.
Hi.
Let's start out, Kimberley, with talking about a little bit about your diagnosis and treatment, and then also why this show is so important to you.
Sure. I'll start with why the show is so important, because it's so important. As you mentioned, I'm a cancer survivor. And one of the things I was chatting about with one of the other girls who I met in the cancer community is that there's not enough resources out there for cancer survivors. And it's like you leave treatment and you're done. And everybody shakes their hand, wipes their hands free of you, and you're done. And the thing is it stays with you, and there's so much that's changed and that's different, and you just don't know how to navigate it. So we just decided that we wanted to put together something. Mm-hmm. So I was diagnosed with cancer 2 days before my 32nd birthday. I was diagnosed with what's known as pseudomyxoma peritonei, and that is commonly lumped together with cancer of the appendix. What I usually hear first is, when I tell people that, is, well, it's cancer of the appendix. Can't they just take the appendix out? And sure, if I had it just in my appendix, then they could have removed it and things would have been great. But unfortunately, by the time they found it, it had progressed quite significantly up through my lungs, my diaphragm and omentum, which I didn't even know about. So treatment for me was surgery. Was pretty much the key treatment. I had 3 surgeries in total, the longest of which was 18 hours. And most of my internal organs that could be removed were. I also had a chemo wash as part of my treatment, instead of the IV chemo. When I was on the operating table, they just pumped the chemo directly into my abdomen, mm-hmm. heated it up to, I don't know, 116, 120 degrees, so it scalded. And then they pumped it directly into my abdomen, swished it around for about 2 hours. And my oncologist said it's like taking a blowtorch to your insides. So that was lovely.
How does this differ in terms of the effects from what most people think of when going through with chemo?
It's a good question. So most people go through chemo or radiation, the IV chemo. So it's over a period of time. There's lots of different effects that some other patients have, like neuropathy, that I fortunately didn't have. Mm-hmm. I didn't lose my hair, which was really cool for me. But it also, I know, impacted my sense of identity in a different way than other cancer survivors. So there are some distinct differences between my treatments and its after effects and other survivors. But I think that, you know, we all talk about being in this one community together because cancer doesn't differentiate. So right. Hopefully the point of today's show is just to try and help other survivors, other people who are transitioning out of treatment, to be able to do it more easily.
Yeah, that's my hope too. Obviously, I've been with you for the entire journey.
Yes, you have.
Thank you.
So
I'm intimately familiar with, you know, what path this took. So you gave us a really good description of, you know, the toll that this took on your body and how that physically affected you. But I know you and I have talked a lot about the less visible results of this whole experience, and I know that is also behind the show today.
Yeah.
What else happens for somebody in your shoes, and what are the challenges coming out of treatment that don't necessarily have to do with your body?
Sure. Well, I think you actually said it really well when we were first discussing the show, that everybody expects a cancer patient to get medical treatment. Everybody expects that patient is going to get chemo. They're going to get the surgeries that they need. They're going to get that. But the mental health aspect of treatment and recovery is so overlooked. I had I fortunately had my very own individual therapist who I'd been seeing before anyways, mm-hmm. and she helped me a lot through the process. But otherwise, in the 2 to 3 months that I was hospitalized, I saw a counselor once or twice, and I didn't really find benefit from that. It wasn't something that was discussed as part of the treatment plan, which I think it needs to be. And then even outside of the treatment, one of the biggest issues that every survivor I've talked to has post-treatment is post-traumatic stress disorder. And it's that depression, it's that anxiety, it's that fear that just pops up when you least expect it. Because cancer really does change you. It changes the way you think, and it changes what you think is possible. So certainly the mental health aspect is incredibly important. And one of the things that really benefited me was the ability to be in a support network with other people who are going through the same thing. And I would encourage anyone who's going through this, or even the caregivers, because that's just as important, to go find those support networks.
So is that something that was, you know, you talked about coming out of treatment and, you know, this piece being overlooked. Was that suggested to you? Did you go out and find resources on your own? What?
I found it on my own. Yep, absolutely. It's funny because since my cancer was different and I was young, mm-hmm. Much younger than most of the patients that I saw in the waiting room or the oncology ward, it was different. It was different to go to support groups. It was different to go onto online resources. There's a lot of support groups for specific types of cancer, okay. But my cancer is a one in a million.
I know.
And so there was no support group for PMP. There was online groups. But online doesn't work for me. I needed to be face-to-face with real people talking about things in real time, so.
Yeah, I know that group was really helpful to you. I was so grateful that you found it.
Yeah.
But like you said, not everybody is lucky enough to know about resources, which is part of the whole point of this show.
And I had time before my biggest treatment in order to research resources.
Yes.
Which not everybody gets. You know, some people, they're diagnosed and they don't leave the hospital until after treatment is over, or at least significantly through. So I really hope that it can become a bigger part of care plans, and also that cancer patients are given a post-treatment plan that they can work through and resources they can call.
Yeah, that would be so wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I know that in addition to, you know, your personal physical body, and you talked about the PTSD a little bit, tell us a little bit about, and I remember this vividly, but I want you to tell your story, you know, returning to work, getting back to real life, and how that was for you.
Yeah, that was crazy. When you are diagnosed, your identity becomes cancer. And, facilitators of our support group told me that it's like a pie plate. And when you're first diagnosed, it takes up the whole plate. Like the whole pie is cancer. And then slowly it starts to shift and other things start to come back into life and the cancer becomes a smaller and smaller part. And that's true. And when you're first transitioning out of treatment, it's still a really big percentage of the pie plate. As you remark, when I was, in my own personal experience, I was job hunting right before my last surgery. And I literally signed the acceptance letter and was negotiating salary and benefits from my hospital bed post-surgery with my amazing mom reading the contracts to make sure I wasn't signing anything I shouldn't.
And of course, they did not know that.
No.
Where you were
exactly.
And what state you were in. I mean, this is a whole part of the transitioning to work, right?
Yes, I had to hide it.
Yeah.
Because I was afraid that if they knew what I was doing or where I was, they wouldn't hire me. And I know there's laws out there to protect people, but it doesn't matter because people find a way to get around the laws.
Well, and I know, I mean, the irony you and I have talked about in doing this show even is because of things like work and potential employers, you don't even want to use your last name
No.
on the show, which I completely understand,
Yeah.
but this goes right to the heart of what we're talking about. You want to have this new identity and to survive and transition and thrive, and yet you still feel like you cannot fully do that.
Yeah, it's crazy, isn't it? I mean, there's all these laws. Cancer's becoming a better known disease. It's better. There are more and more survivors than there were before. But at the same time, I worry about using my last name because what if a potential employer Googles me mm-hmm. and finds this video on YouTube?
Absolutely.
Which I definitely want people to see. But a future employer might see that and think, she could have a remission. I should probably go with the other candidate who isn't as risky.
Right, because you might be needing to take time off for a medical procedure.
Which I have to do.
Right, you do.
Mm-hmm. And that's part of working post-treatment, too, is your body is changed. And there are new conditions that come up as a result of your treatment. So, case in point, I'm anemic now. And I can't absorb iron the way other people do, so I have to go in for infusions. I actually came from my blood test to the studio today. So I had to go in for infusions, and they were 2 to 3 hours once a week for 6 weeks, and my boss was not happy about that.
Yeah.
It brought me out of the office too much. People were wondering what was going on, if I was going to be coming back, was I reliable? It's unfortunate that even when you do take that time out to take care of your changed body, that sometimes there can be perceptions in the workplace that can limit your experience.
Well, and I remember how, you know, upsetting this has been. And again, I've lived through it with you. On top of everything else, the fact that you have to worry about that when mm-hmm. all you're trying to do is take care of your basic health needs
right.
that are different now and
yep.
special.
Absolutely different.
From what they might have been before.
I can't eat things that I used to be able to eat. I miss mushrooms.
I know. We can never have mushrooms anymore.
No.
Which is okay.
And you make a good stuffed mushroom. things are changed. You know, they, as part of the treatment, they bring your body as close to death as they can in order to kill the cancer. I was lucky that it was over a very short period of time, you know, during my 18-hour surgery. But the recovery was difficult, and there was a lot of ways that my body was changed and will never be the same.
No. It took a big toll. You know, one of the things you and I have talked about, and for me personally, that I have, I don't know, I've absorbed through your eyes and your experience, is the notion that probably a lot of survivors have of really regaining this focus on what is important in life, what to grab hold of,
yeah.
how to rediscover your passions and your identity beyond being a cancer patient. And tell us a little bit about the things you've done.
So, amazing point. Even today, when I was chatting with someone and they asked, you know, oh, you're a cancer survivor. And I'm like, yeah. And it was interesting because I actually still feel like someone who has cancer. Technically, I'm 3 years cancer free, but I still feel that I have cancer, that is part of my identity. And who knows, maybe 15 years from now, that'll be different. That pie plate will be smaller.
Mm-hmm.
But it changes your identity. One of the things about just being diagnosed, I think, is that you're, even, you know, before you are allowed to transition out of treatment, your priorities shift, your focuses change. Things that were important before, you just don't care as much about.
Like what?
Like the drama, everyday drama in a workplace, or the small stuff, just the everyday little things that maybe would have gotten to you bigger, but you're just like, yeah, that's okay.
Is that a blessing in a way?
Absolutely.
To kind of really hone in on the things that are
absolutely
important.
And I'm not sure it's true for everybody, but I think that when you face your mortality and you're able to come back from that, things are changed and they're different. And I think it's good if they can be, because it reminds you of what's important. My family, which of course I would have said that was important before, but they're important in a different way. My son, and one of the things, pursuing my passions.
Yes,
so,
I wanted to talk about
yes.
that.
So I was recently in a play and on stage for the first time in 10 years. And I couldn't even believe that I had let 10 years go by without being in a play.
Because it, for you and both of us, it's been
huge.
A regular
I love it.
Passion.
It makes me feel alive in a way that nothing else really does, in a way that nothing else can. So, you know, things like that. I was able to remember to pursue those passions.
Right, which is so important. I mean,
absolutely. And it's important for self-care.
Yes.
I mean, when you're transitioning out of care, all of a sudden you don't have those nurses and your social workers and everything else reminding you how to take care of yourself and take care of your body. Mm-hmm. So when you're transitioning out of care, it is so important to remember to take care of yourself,
right.
Not just physically, but really mentally as well.
And emotionally.
Okay. Using your support network, cutting yourself slack. One thing. I think you've helped me with that a lot in cutting myself
some
slack.
Not to expect so much of yourself. We should all do that anyway.
Right.
Should all cut ourselves a break. But, you know, your body and to an extent your mind, at least for a while, was affected. Mm-hmm. And you haven't been able to do as much or as quickly. And that's okay.
Yeah.
But you've actually been able to do an amazing amount, I would say. And it inspires me. To see that.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask, you know, we're talking about these challenges of transitioning. You know, if you could go back to yourself pre-surgery, post-surgery, or to someone else who might be watching the show, what advice might you wish you had had, or just what are some important things for somebody to know?
Have a therapist.
Okay. Yeah.
Because the post-traumatic stress creeps up on you when you least expect it. And that's one thing that I've found to be present in almost every single survivor I've talked to. Use your support network. Be kind to yourself. I mean, one of the things is, and I forget who actually wrote it on my blog, but my body had been through this incredible shock. And after treatment, your body is still in shock, but your mind is too. And it takes a while to recalibrate. So just be kind, cut yourself slack, and find what resources and utilize them whenever you can. There's lots of resources out there. We'll have a list at the end of the show. But use them. Don't be afraid. And go to the groups, join online forums, talk to whoever will listen.
Right. And what about other people? I know we may talk about this further in future segments, but I know there were a lot of people who wanted to help you afterwards, family, friends, coworkers, and I know from our talks that, you know, you didn't necessarily look sick. You hadn't lost your hair.
Mm-hmm.
People want to do something. They want to say something useful and encouraging. And, you know, nobody prepares us for this. Your coworkers, as kind as they may be, may say, you know, some things that just aren't that helpful in a certain case. So, you know, what would you have needed, or what do people need?
You know, I think one of the things that helped me the most was people just saying, you're gonna get through this. You're doing a great job. Keep fighting, keep going. We're here with you, we love you. And I think that was one of the things that resonated the most with me. And on the flip side, when people said, oh, you look great, it almost hurt a little bit because I felt horrible.
Yeah.
The inside of my body was still so traumatized, and I might have looked good on the outside, but I didn't feel good on the inside. So I actually read a really interesting article about this on Facebook the other day, which was kind of like, you know, ask what's up instead of how are you feeling. Try to focus for people who are, you know, in that person's life. Focus on the individual rather than the disease. Because the disease is so prevalent in us, it's nice for us to be able to be thought of outside of that. And also, don't ask, what can I do to help?
No.
Because people, I don't know. I have no idea what I need. And even if I do, I have a really hard time asking for specifics. So a better thing is to say, hey, can I bring you dinner? Or what you did, can I organize people to bring dinner for you? And I'm like, thank you. Can I, you know, would, can I take your son out for a play date? That was great when people did that. Can I take your husband out for coffee? So I knew he was being taken care of. Because taking care of the patient and the survivor is huge. Taking care of the people that they love helps them to worry less.
One thing I don't want to skip over is, you know, a lot of people talk about being a survivor. And in fact, it is part of the title of our show. Excuse me. And it's very common, and there are a lot of emotions around that. You've been through this huge thing, and you've come out. You're still standing. But I know that you have chosen a different term for yourself. Mm-hmm. And what is that, and why is it so special to you?
It's a very important term for me. Rather than calling myself a survivor, which is great for a lot of people, I prefer to call myself a cancer warrior.
A warrior.
A warrior. Because to me, a warrior is someone who goes out and does battle. It's someone who is consciously making a decision to do this, to fight, to stand up against something that seems insurmountable. And survivor, to me, feels like, oh, it happened to me, and I got through it.
Right.
I have a friend who likes to call herself a doer, and I'm like, okay. To me, that's not quite as powerful, but it works for her, but it's something active. And that's very important to me, and that's why I got a tattoo to celebrate my new post-cancer body that says, now I am a warrior. And it's on my shoulder. So
yes.
You can't really tell where it is from the photo, but it's on my right shoulder.
It's on the right shoulder.
And yeah, so I wanted to get this tattoo. I wanted to find a way to celebrate my body post-cancer.
Yes.
And to celebrate the scars and the trauma and everything. Celebrate everything that it had been through. And I decided on a tattoo. And I love it. It was the most important thing. And then knowing that I wanted more tattoos on my back, I had the artist design a whole back piece around this one phrase. Now I am a warrior.
Thing. Yeah. Well, and it feels when I talk to you, I know, and there's, you know, I know you're not, we're not making any commentary on people who call themselves survivors. Like
if
you said,
it works, it's great.
It's whatever feels comfortable
whatever
and right
resonates.
For you. Mm-hmm. But this notion, I like this notion that you have chosen for yourself, which is that you are an active participant in propelling yourself through this experience and doing everything you can to not let it dictate while you stand by.
Right. And, you know, I think every patient undergoing treatment feels like that. It does that, whether they're vocal about it or not. Every patient out there is a warrior, and I think that's really important for everybody to recognize.
Has that changed at all as you've gotten more time away from this most recent surgery, or do you still feel like you're fighting?
I'm fighting every day. Maybe I'm fighting different battles. The cancer was something I wasn't thinking about as much Until recently, until thinking about this show, until using it as emotional memories for the play that I was in. But it comes back. And even if it's not every day, the memories come back, the emotions come back, and it's still a part.
Right. Well, and you mentioned, you know, to go back to the beginning of the show, yeah, the PTSD, and I know that that comes up for you because even as a survivor, as a warrior, it's not necessarily over. You need to go back in for scans and get your blood checked and things like that. So the fight continues.
The fight continues. One of the biggest things that, you know, most cancer patients can relate to is the scanxiety. The pure terror you feel before you have to go and get your next scan, whether it's an MRI, a CT scan, an ultrasound, but basically that regular check to see if the tumors are back. And it's terrifying, absolutely terrifying, because you have to entertain the possibility that it might be there. And it's not fun. That pops up. The mental health aspect of it pops up, and it can be crippling. For about 2 weeks after I scheduled my MRI, I wasn't able to really focus that well on work, on anything, because I was so terrified.
Yeah. Well, we have so much more to say.
So much more.
In wrapping up, first of all, I want to say how proud I am of you. To have the courage, I'm getting a little choked up, to have the courage to come on TV in front of an audience and revisit a time in your life that was incredibly painful and challenging in the hopes that you can provide hope to others. And we hope that this is the first in an installment of different programs tackling different issues. Mm-hmm. A couple of those we hope to cover.
I think the next one we need to do really is caregivers and focusing on caregivers, because it's so important. It's critical. They're an important part of the process. We can do anything without our caregivers. So I think caregivers, and I want to do something just on PTSD alone, because it's such a huge topic. Returning to work and the legal resources.
We will cover those.
Yep.
And there will be some resources after the show that come up. And we have an email. The email, real quick.
TransitioningFromCancer@gmail.com. Again, that is TransitioningFromCancer@gmail.com.
Thank you.
Thank you. But you gotta keep your head up, oh, and you can let your head down.